You're with Strat News Global. I'm Amitabh Ravi, and on the gist, we're looking at the essence of the situation in Afghanistan. Extremely glad to be joined from London by Ambassador Shukriya Barakzai. She's a former Afghanistan ambassador to Norway. She's been a Walesi Jirga, Lower House of Parliament MP, and activist in her own right, apart from these positions. Ambassador Barakzai, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Also from the capital, Delhi, is Ambassador Vivek Kaju. He needs no introduction for all our viewers in and around India. He's been India's ex-envoy to Afghanistan and also a former secretary at the Ministry of External Affairs. Ambassador Kaju, glad to have you back, sir, on a topic I know you are really passionate about.
Thank you.
Just before I get into the discussion on the situation in Afghanistan, just want to play out a soundbite of Ned Price, that's the U.S. State Department spokesperson, when he is asked about these documents that are circulating in Kabul.
For the president in region X, Y, or Z, will pursue what's in our interests and what's consistent with our values. And in many cases, what is in our interests and consistent with our values will be to push back on adventurism on the part of Russia or China. But I would hesitate to apply a cookie cutter model to it, because each situation, each region is going to be somewhat different. What isn't different?
This is actually a soundbite when he was talking about the situation with China and the policy with China. But he was also asked about these documents, and we'll play out some of the documents that Tolo News exclusively put out first, which is a roadmap that the Americans have laid out before the Afghan polity, as well as a document that is purportedly written by Secretary of State Blinken. This is the 8-page document that Tolo put out. Ambassador Barakzai, I mean, everyone's seen this now, even though it's officially publicly not been acknowledged as being genuine, but we do know it is that. What is your view of, again, now, after this is the first step of a review that the Biden administration is doing on Afghanistan policy, where it seems, again, the Americans are putting a deal down the Afghan throats?
Well, from my understanding, America is one of the important allies to Afghanistan, but also I believe Americans should give values for the sacrifice of their own men and women, which is their service in Afghanistan, time and billions of dollars they spend against the war and terror. The most important thing is the structure of the future of the peace deal. It must be by the hands of Afghans. So what Afghanistan need, what Afghanistan wants, and what can save the Afghanistan.
I'll just get Ambassador Barakzai back on there from London. But Ambassador Kachu, you have been telling us on Strat News, and you've been publicly saying this for years now, that the Americans are exiting, they have surrendered, there's been no change. Would you say for Biden's stance vis-a-vis Afghanistan?
Look, realistically speaking, what options do the Americans have? They are exhausted. It's been 20 years of their involvement in Afghanistan with their forces present there. They've tried everything through the application of force, and it simply hasn't worked. And we've discussed this often. It hasn't worked because they refuse to cross the Durand to clean up the Taliban sanctuaries within Pakistan. And as long as that they existed, the Taliban had a hinterland to which they couldn't retreat. And that is why they came back strongly. And over the years, I think Ambassador Barakzai is right, they extracted a very heavy toll in terms of American lives and also treasure. But then I think the Americans came to the conclusion that they had simply no option but to gulp their pride and to extricate themselves from Afghanistan. And initially, if you recollect, President Trump tried all his theatrics with Pakistan and the Taliban and cut no ice. And thereafter, it was just a question of cutting a deal and perhaps the best deal possible with the Taliban and with the Pakistanis backing the Taliban. Now, Biden has inherited that situation. In order to change that situation, he will have to go back to fundamental. And given the current economic situation in America, given the fact that America's first priority is to get over the COVID pandemic, he does not simply have any alternative but to continue with the course that Trump had set. The only change is, and I find this ironic, that instead of shouldering all this himself, or America shouldering it itself, he has tried to involve other countries, including Russia and China, and of course India, Pakistan and Iran, as a group to shoulder this responsibility to see that there is an orderly exit of American troops, of NATO troops, and that the Americans don't leave Afghanistan as they did after the Soviet withdrawal in 1989. So given that, I think the template is set. And all that we are now seeing is how the Americans want it to be played. And there are naturally imponderables here. There are question marks, both arising from Afghanistan's domestic situation and the concerns of different domestic players in Afghanistan and the external players.
Ambassador Barakzai, you were cut short in terms of the network. You want to finish your thought?
I totally agree with the ambassador. Whatever His Excellency says, I just want to echo the same. And I think from my point of view, it's very important for the country in the region to cooperate with the government of Afghanistan, with the democracy in the region, and plus for a sustainable Afghanistan and secure Afghanistan. Otherwise, if we go and see, if we couldn't learn from the history, what happened during early 1990s, I think Afghanistan can be another safe land for the terrorist networks. And I believe the exit policy from Trump and currently Joe Biden administration, it may not happen because if we like or not, United States have a very deep interest in the region. I believe they cannot leave Afghanistan as it is. But of course, inviting Russia, Iran, Pakistan, India, and other countries which is they are interested in Afghanistan peace deal, I think it's a kind of they try to respond when Russian criticizing a lot that they were not been recognized for the peace process in Afghanistan. And we shouldn't ignore the relationship of Taliban between Iran and between Russia. So that may be between Pakistan. That may be also the cause that Taliban have like a really strong voice through to the different channels, including a lobby group from Pakistan for them. So that may help for Taliban to be unrealistically in a position to talk and sign document with the United States of America or to globally will be recognized as a group to be recognizing for a peace deal among Afghan. If it's a peace process is an Afghan internal issue, and I think it needs to be led by Afghanistan according to what Afghan people need. I agree that we need peace for region and of course for Afghanistan first, as being Afghan, it's very important. But in the meantime, which price is that will lead Afghanistan to a long-term peace, or it will be just a shortcut for another catastrophe and disaster in the region, and especially in Afghanistan? And I think every single step any players wants to take it's very a crucial moment because it's not anymore Afghanistan, which is it was in early 2000. Now Afghanistan has been suffering from lots of other terrorist network within Afghanistan and lots of other countries' interest been related to Afghanistan. And that's why I believe this is the time that every player should take the responsibility. I understand the frustration and the fatigues of among nation, and including Afghans first, but it shouldn't lead us that we should couldn't see at the end of the tunnel a light for peace. What is the current platform United States offered to people of Afghanistan as a result of peace negotiation? No one is disagree for an inclusive government. Yes, any government in Afghanistan should consider the political players to bring among them. But if the power sharing among Afghan and Taliban, and that's especially in the which in a battlefield, it will be a little bit unrealistic. If you put Taliban plus Afghan National Army together and ask them to go and stand together and work together for the security, I think mentally both sides will may not be ready to cooperate the way we were looking for them. Sure. Most of the time, lots of documents was been made for Afghanistan, so unrealistic and away from the reality on the ground. So that's why none of the policy wasn't work as it should. And I believe for United States, I'm sure still they didn't say this is the last decision. They said they're going to review the policy. So I think, and this is the time for us as a two country, as a two nation, as a sovereign nation, that we should stand for and to be stick about the security in the region. And of course, India is Afghanistan's friend. And we would like to call our Indian friends also to join us in the lobby to avoid any kind of conflict of interest in Afghanistan. I believe it's a chance. If we give, if we look from the angle of chance, if Afghanistan can be a point that every country will look, okay, peace in Afghanistan, security in Afghanistan, it will be also my interest in the region, we can move forward. But if every other player...
The reason why it's gone on for 42 years is precisely because everyone is working their interest.
Looking for theirs, yes.
Ambassador Karju, sorry, excuse me. When you look at what has been leaked there, it is clearly a fait accompli. I mean, it's take it all. I mean, take it. There's no, you can't even leave it for the Afghan administration, government, polity. What do you think the Americans are doing vis-a-vis the Taliban? Is there a riot act being read there because of the conditionalities of the Doha deal are not being met? And if you look at Sirajuddin Haqqani's latest statement that was given this month, he's issuing threats about drones and missiles that they have if the Doha deal is not implemented. Ambassador Karju.
Look, I'm a little amused when I hear of American threats. Of course, they can bring about enormous kinetic power to bear through the air on the Taliban and different entities of the Taliban. But will that get them the desired result? And that result is extricating themselves from Afghanistan. And one has to appreciate that they've been there for 20 years and 20 years has exhausted, as I said earlier. Now, given this situation, the fact is that everyone, and I for one, who am a friend of Afghanistan and I've followed Afghanistan professionally for over 2.5 decades, would have very much liked that the old paradigm that was put in place to be achieved in Afghanistan in 2002 was actually achieved. But it did not. It was not achieved for a whole variety of reasons. And we can go into it. There were failures on all sides. It will serve us no purpose to post-mortem those. Of course, it should be done. But at the moment, it will serve us no purpose. So what is the present situation? The present situation is that the Americans have come out with this draft plan or draft ideas. And I think these ideas, they say, are based on their conversations with all the parties. Mm-hmm. But certainly, I can see enormous difficulties in both Kabul as well as the Taliban accepting some of the fundamental ideas that have been set out. So how will that be? How will they be reconciled? I do not know. Those are the domestic factors relating to this deal. The external factors are, first of all, it is good that Iran has joined them. They've asked Iran to join. If it had been Trump, he would have not done so. But Biden has been realistic. Afghan is an influential neighbor of Afghanistan, and he has, and they've asked him. But the omission of the Central Asian neighbors is glaring.
Hmm.
And it will, will happen.
The EU is not mentioned in that document.
EU is not mentioned, well, because of the transatlantic partnership which has been invigorated by Biden. EU may be part of the consultative process. But as far as the Central Asian neighbors are concerned, it well may be that Russia and China both may lean on the Americans, and because this will be under the UN rubric, may lean on the Americans and the UN to include them in this group of six. Now, then is India's inclusion. As far as I'm concerned, it is a very satisfactory development because India has major interests. India is an old friend of Afghanistan, friend within quotes, friend in the sense Indian interests and Afghan interests coincide in large measure. And therefore, Afghanistan affects India's security interests. So, India's presence is a good development as far as I'm concerned.
Do you see it as a change from before? I'm just taking a question that's coming from Harsh Bihari as well, Ambassador Kaju. Please ask the ambassador why Russia was opposed to the Indian presence in the talks. There were some reports that was happening, and there is another report suggesting that the Moscow format will resume on 18th, I think, of this month. And all sides, including President Ghani, have been asked to appoint a 1+1 members to go there. Ambassador Kaju.
As far as the Russians are concerned, they may be on Afghanistan. There has been a divergence of opinion developing between India and Russia over a period of time, and that related principally to the Taliban. I think the Russians were asking us to be realistic. We were fairly rigid about not accepting the Taliban, not recognizing the Taliban, whereas all others had implicitly or explicitly. And that developed this gap between Russia and us. And now we still don't have any dealings with the Taliban openly. At least so, I think that may be a cause. Then, of course, for Russia and China, the Pakistan factor is there. So that will may be contributing to Russia's views on India's inclusion. But certainly, I think there is the aspect of the larger India-US strategic partnership, and India's concerns have been taken on board. But having said all this, the principal question to my mind is this, and that is what I think the Kabul elite, of which my co-panelist is such a prominent member, has to ask itself this terribly hard question. Mm-hmm. It's a very unpleasant question too. And that question is this: does it have the wherewithal to take on the Taliban? Because that is what it ultimately in the world of real politics boils down to.
But take on the Taliban on its own? I mean, you don't expect that.
My co-panelist is a Barakzai. Oh. And the little that I know of Afghanistan, a prominent Barakzai compatriot was President Hamid Karzai, for whom I have enormous respect, who was a Popalzai chief. Did he, in his tenure try to come out of the ARC and take the leadership, if not of all the peoples of Afghanistan, at least of the Pashtuns. How many times did he go to Kandahar? How many times? I know there were security concerns. How many times did he travel over the Pashtun lands to take leadership? And Because there was this vacuum, and President Ghani, who's an Ahmadzai, continued with the same thing. Because there was this vacuum, who filled it? It was filled by the Taliban. Am I saying something wrong? If I am, please correct me. I know that the Taliban represent a medieval kind of conception, but in the Pashtun heartland, they were given a free run. They were allowed a free run for these two decades, and we know what has happened.
In terms of leadership, Ambassador Barakzai, especially from the top, your response?
From my understanding, Taliban is more ideology group rather than ethnic group. When it comes to Pashtun leadership, I believe Afghanistan having an election, which is people of Afghanistan are deciding who are the leaders. I believe a terrorist network can never represent any kind of ethnicity in Afghanistan. And we shouldn't forget that where areas are very close to our neighbor Pakistan, with their cooperation, of course, Taliban can control and lead those areas and those lands. But can I say what Taliban offered to those Pashtuns under their control area? Which kind of prosperity, peace, and security people are enjoying there? Is the Taliban are really representing Pashtuns and large, or they are just an ideology group by support of our neighboring country, and especially Pakistan? They are growing up, and right now the blossom of their time comes, but it wouldn't exist for so long, because what is, they don't have any sympathy with the Afghan soil. They are just killing and destroying. There should be a kind of definition between terrorist network groups and government. If Karzai couldn't lead Pashtuns and large, Taliban cannot claim that leadership at all.
And when you're talking about Pakistan, Ambassador Kaju, are just taking some more comments that have come in from some of our regular viewers. Tanuj Abbe Khanna, who says, absolute shame that the Taliban, that is Pakistan, holds the stick of the spring and winter offensive, and we're waiting for that. One of the reasons apparently for this roadmap that the Americans have given is to prevent that happening, while the West complains of fatigue. Ambassador Kaju?
I have great sympathy for the sentiment that has been expressed. Of course, it's a shame. But shame is of little meaning in the world of real politics. Shame has literally no substance when it comes to deciding on events. It is not a determinant factor. We've got to look at these things with complete clarity and ruthless reality if we want to achieve objectives and interests. After all, this game is one of interest, and I entirely concur with Ambassador Barakzai that the Taliban represent an ideology for which I, for one, have no sympathy. I cannot agree more. But the reality is that they have been, through whatever instruments they have employed with the help of Pakistan, been able to prevent the return of peace and stability in Afghanistan, despite the presence over 20 years of American troops, who at one stage, as Amitabh, you yourself have shown, were over 100,000. Now, the last sentence, the fact is that all this has happened because the Americans refused to cross the Durand to clean up the mess in Pakistan. That is a fact. I mean, there were a variety of reasons why they didn't want to do that, but that is a fact, and that is what has led us to the situation today. And we must face the situation today. And the today's situation is they are tired. The Americans are tired. The West is tired. They will put no more men there and women. And therefore, when I say that I concede the Taliban have this ideological situation. But if the Pashtun were rallied, then Ambassador Barakzai will not, I hope, disagree with me that they would have ensured, the people would have ensured that the Taliban could not gain a foothold. I saw this process when I was ambassador, India's ambassador in Kabul. And I remind Ambassador Barakzai, it began as early as 2003 when they started making inroads into Zabul. And then from Zabul, they used to go into Uruzgan and set up their bases and started developing areas of influence quietly. And within the next 3 or 4 years, they were a going concern. So we've seen all this. So that is why I've been submitting the thought that that a vacuum was left for them to operate. It gives me no joy to say this. But this is what is the reality. And I'm stating the reality.
The reality now, or where does the Afghan nation, the polity, go from now that you've been handed over this ultimatum, if I can call it that, from the US?
Well, I believe that there is a nation and there is a government, despite of how this government was been treating by United States or by other allies, despite of how Taliban, by their own terrorist activity, got the floor and prestige and recognition today. I believe that the nation of Afghans, first, they are not representing terrorists. Second, they were not accepting a terrorist leaders. That's why when it comes the issue of election for the future and for the next government, Taliban are not accepting that. So that's exact sign that Taliban have a big fear of fair election. They can, because they believe they cannot represent the people of Afghanistan, they wouldn't be able to achieve political power by the electoral vote when it comes to the choice of people, okay? But right now, we understand the situation in Afghanistan is not either domestically or internationally, or not really as it should be. It is not. Everything is going against the nation because our leaders are coming and going. But what is existing is the nation and national interest. So by having Taliban as a peace, as a deal of peace within a government, if they are coming and going to be civilized, accepting the rules of democratic state, not a barbaric or a totalitarian or a kind of Nazism, they're most welcome. But as long as they are denying and they are not cutting their tail with other terrorist networks, I'm sure the slam from the nation will be very soon on their face. We shouldn't forget how Afghanistan was been living in early 1990 by the United States and other Western alliance. And they paid the consequence and the result by 9/11. So I don't want Afghanistan will be a trip line that other countries will have a fear of it. So that's why we have to cooperate with each other to make that kind of global terrorist networks to do not find anymore any safe haven for themselves. And let me say, today Afghanistan is not Afghanistan in 1996 where Taliban lead and take over Afghanistan. Today the new generation of Afghanistan are asking totally something else. Today, they are criticizing the government because of the weak leadership, corruption, and lack of security. And besides, they don't have any interest or sympathy with the Taliban either. They say, yes, Taliban are reality. I have to accept them as a reality. That's why I want to challenge them. Come and let's both of us run for the election and let's ask public opinion. Let's see who will get more support. But right now, the identity for Taliban is not the reality. They don't have control of 70% of the geography in Afghanistan. They don't have even 50% of that. We know they cannot even have the capacity of civil leadership, civilian leadership, they cannot lead offices. They don't know what is diplomacy means. They don't know what strategy means. It's totally different circumstances. But unfortunately, when Big Boss, United States, they are with the side of kind of Taliban and they show like more sympathy, I'm sure they will understand that none of terrorist network can be a reliable partner for any state. And that includes Taliban.
Ambassador Karchu, so where do you see this going down the road?
Look, let me say straight away that I recognize the anguish which Ambassador Barzai is articulating today, and I'm sure that anguish is shared widely in the Kabul elite. Of course, I agree that in the last 20 years, a new generation has come up, and of Afghans, and that generation has known the world. It can't, and therefore, the return of a situation as it obtained in the 1990s under the Taliban Islamic Emirate can simply not be countenanced either by the people of Afghanistan or by the international community. I mean, that is a given. However, there is this reality of the Taliban. Pakistan's support is continuing. And that reality has to be faced. So, the complications in the road ahead are going to be enormous. I don't see any easy resolution. I'm somewhat pessimistic, I must confess. I hope I'm proved wrong. But there will be very, very significant hurdles. But the one thing that I don't see, quite frankly, is the balance being tilted against the Taliban through military action, because the West has made it clear that they will not put more people in Afghanistan, more boots on the ground, even if they don't pull out their present force.
Completely.
No one else, no other country is going to do so. So if that is the situation, then what we have seen over the past few years in terms of a creeping advance of Taliban within Afghanistan, and I concede Ambassador Barzai's point that they don't hold too much of territory, but they have one card. And that card is the prevention of a return of peace and stability, which today the Afghans and the international community desire. So therefore, I can't tell you precisely how it will play out because of the numerous imponderables. I can tell you that there are enormous difficulties and we can plot out those difficulties. But I do see that there is, and I'm sorry if I'm repeating myself, there is exhaustion in the West, and they just want to cut and go and not spend any more lives or any great treasure in Afghanistan. They, of course, want to ensure that Afghanistan does not become a base for any terrorist action against their interests. But beyond that, I don't see much. And therefore, it is for the Afghan people realistically to resolve this and to find a way ahead. And that is, I believe, what the Afghan people want.
And the Afghan people to resolve this, Ambassador Barzai, how can partners like India help in this situation when the Americans are leaving?
Allow me to share my one sentence at least. In Afghanistan, absolutely, war and peace never was Afghans. It never was for Afghanistan, starting from early 70s to now. It's others' interest. It's for others. It never was for Afghans and Afghans' prosperity or Afghanistan or for the people of Afghanistan. So that's why every players are using Afghanistan as a ground to play. And they have their own goal, they have their own players, they have their own balls. It wouldn't be easy to to bring all the players in one platform, because there's a conflict interest that when their interests are not common, when there's an interest in conflict, it will get more longer, that peace procedure. But I'm not sure which kind of guarantee can Taliban will give to the rest of the world that there will be no safe land anymore for terrorists, one. And second, according to the experience from 29 February 2020 till now, it shows still they have very good and close cooperation with foreign fighters within Afghanistan and outside of Afghanistan. They didn't cut their tails. So for the people of Afghanistan, we learn. We learn from our history. We learn from the current situation. I believe with the proper political settlement, with an inclusive vision, we can bring all political players in a circle, which is that circles will guarantee the future of Afghanistan. Despite of Taliban wants or not, we cannot say entire Afghanistan will go to the hands of Taliban. There are some other groups that their interest will be in conflict with the Taliban interest. So again, there's a no kind of, let's say, guarantee, not for the international partners, not for the Afghans. I can say there is a chance, as it mentioned on the letter, and also as we can see the options for the going to the peace process. And this is the time we need all friends, including India, to put their effort for a stable Afghanistan. Afghanistan should be a part that all neighbors should feel comfort with them rather than scared. And India has been historically Afghanistan friends, so we have lots of shared interests. We have to tackle our shared interests as a stable partner, not as a someone coming and going and leaving. And I'm sure the United States will also review their strategy, because as far as my concern, there might be a different opinion among military part and non-military within the United States, because everyone knows how strategically Afghanistan is important. I understand how international community are been exhausting from their presence in Afghanistan, but in the meanwhile, they also understand how important is Afghanistan for them. Otherwise, no one would be ready to pay for free their treasure or life for Afghans. Everyone is there for their own interest. But the important is, and this is, I think, our own homework, Afghanistan homework, and the Friends of Afghanistan homework, to build a reliable coalition among ourselves to stand for shared interest and principle. When those principles can be a loud voice for us, I think we can make the rest of the world to be agree with us.
Ambassador Barksa, as you're pointing out, through history, other countries, other neighbors and global powers have used Afghanistan as a battleground. But as Ambassador Karju has been pointing out, the Afghans themselves have been not unified as well. Ambassador Karju, a brief comment on India's role and how you see that going. We may have been named in the American document, but how do you see India positioning itself, dealing with the Taliban? We are the only country that's not officially or openly talking to the Taliban.
Well, if the American plan is what it is with regard to the so-called peace government, which is to be formed, which is going to have equal representation of the Taliban and the present Afghan government, then I see India's role as, of course, ensuring that its own interests, first of all, are secured. And there's no harm in my saying this, because this is the reality of the world. Countries look after their interests. But I don't believe that our interests clash in any way with the basic interests of Afghanistan. I believe they coincide, so that is a good thing. And I believe that in this, India must maintain contacts with all Afghan friends, with the government and with other Afghan groups in Afghanistan, And if the whole world is now in contact with the Taliban, India can't remain rigid and say it will not engage the Taliban openly. Now, that doesn't mean endorsing what the Taliban stand for or the Taliban's ideology, as Ambassador Barakzai so well put it. But it does mean an engagement, an exchange of ideas to explain where India stands, what India thinks would be good for Afghanistan. It's not for us to impose, but certainly we can make suggestions and to try to also inform them of the realities of the world. Perhaps their leadership has remained for far too long cocooned in Pakistan, in KP, in Balochistan, and has not been exposed to the world, though that's difficult to believe in this age of the social media. But certainly, an exposure to India would do them no harm. If at all, it will do them good.
Ambassador Kachi, we're just playing out the December meeting between the Taliban leaders led by Mullah Baradar when they went to Pakistan, met Prime Minister Imran Khan, and of course, the General Bajwa we saw earlier, Khalilzada, Ambassador Khalilzada also moving there before he went back to Doha. Ambassador Kachi, really appreciate your time and your experience. Thanks for appearing on Strat News yet again.
Thank you.
Ambassador Barakzai, again, thank you for coming in from London, and we do hope we'll keep coming back to you for more as the situation develops. Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
All our subscribers and viewers, do get onto our website. You can help support our kind of journalism. Do also follow all our social media handles on Twitter, on Facebook, and Instagram as well. You've been watching The Gist on Strat News Global. I'm Amitabh Ravi.